Yay! We're on episode 18 of Dixon Drawing Class. Well, my goodness. Welcome to episode 18. We are 3/4 of the way through this class. You've probably gotten a lot better since we began. I'm really excited because now is the episode we're going to be talking about environments and then how to do your own project. And this is where things start to get really fun. Now, environments and backgrounds and things are so important that we have a 3-part lecture on it. And today is the first part. We're going to be talking about how to draw backgrounds. So let's begin. So what I've got here are a bunch of animation backgrounds that I've collected from Pinterest. They don't have to be animation if you want to collect backgrounds from movies, from photos, things like that, and just like wedding photography or landscape photography or anything like that. It's all legit. I like animation backgrounds because they're meant to have somebody, some action going on in it, and so it clears a space. It has a space cleared for people to walk on and stuff. Let's talk about how to draw these. This is from a video game background. This is from a video game. And the first thing I do when I pull up a picture is I draw how big the rectangle is. Okay, so I draw its borders. This looks about right. Okay. So then once I have that down, the next thing I do is I draw the horizon line. That is very important. And sometimes it looks like this is just at a little bit of a slant. I like to mark where the horizon line is in the composition and then I like to mark where the horizon line is according to the sides of the composition, and then I connect it. And you'll find that you do that a lot is making a lot of markers where the line goes and things like that. Okay, and then I think the next important thing to do is to get the walls down. All right, so it looks like this wall begins here, and it goes maybe over to here. And it's a lot of Cartesian map figuring out. Looks like this wall begins here, stops maybe right about here, so we draw that line. Okay, this wall kind of goes up like this, maybe stops right there. Maybe stops up here. Like this, and the same dealio here. This goes here. Actually, I think this is back a little bit. Goes about right here, like this. All right, we have a ceiling. I actually think this is down lower here, kind of like this. Okay, so we have our basic blocking. How this room is run. Sometimes it helps to draw a perspective grid on the planes like this, and that's just how the lines, you know, kind of stretch out over the plane and disappear into the vanishing point sort of thing. So if that helps, go ahead and draw those. All right, then we do a window. Looks like this is actually a lot closer to this wall. Like this. This. We have these spider vaults going on here. Like this. It looks like we have a statue in this background. Can you see how blocking out the basic walls and shapes of it actually really builds a strong foundation for how you're going to be drawing the background? Because once you do that, you know pretty much where all the lines go, you know, how to space the pillars like what we have here. Like this. We know where the reflection is going to fall because we've drawn the perspective grid. Okay, we have a pillar right about here. And it looks like there's a desk or something right here. So we fill that out. Okay. And there's a wheel or something right there. Spider vaults. Okay. Oh, there was a pedestal right here. We'll see if we can get that down. Okay, so this is really rough, but it's giving you the idea. You could spend a long time on it, and I do want you to spend longer when you practice it on getting the backgrounds and the planes and everything down. But this is the basic idea, is blocking it out like that. We're just going to quickly go through a few more. Let's do this escalator scene. Now I'm pressing shift as I draw these lines so that they're straight, so I'm kind of cheating. If you're working in Photoshop, you can do that, or you can freehand it. By now you should be really good at straight lines, right? You've been practicing them?
Yeah.
Look at this vanishing point. You can see it. Let's draw that vanishing point. Looks like it's about right here. Horizon line is about right here. One thing that's nice about this is that it's framed really nicely. Elements in the foreground a lot of times can frame the picture. They usually show up as pretty dark, like this one. It ends up looking nice. Okay, let's draw this ceiling bit. Okay, let's draw the wall here. It looks like the floor kind of goes like that. I love drawing backgrounds so much. It's my jam. You will probably love it too. Okay, looks like goes about right here. We have the escalators. Go ahead and block those in as a rectangle like this. So you can see these also lead to that vanishing point right there. So we're going to mark that like that. Okay. So we could go on forever drawing this. And it could take forever. But for the purposes of time constraints, we're just gonna do it rough. You could fill it out a lot more detailed at home. Let's see. This one would be good to practice. Let's do this one. Looks like it's from a Mr. Magoo or something, UPA piece from the mid-century, mid-1900s. Okay, horizon line, let's get that down. Let's get this down. The side of the building. You may want to start out with simpler backgrounds like this, so that you don't get discouraged and you can kind of just clearly see where the horizon is, and you know, simple shapes to block out might be easier to handle as you're learning to do this. Let's see, we have this. We'll erase that. looks like we have the sidewalk edge right here. And then if you look, they've already made a perspective grid for us. Hey, that makes it a little bit easier, right? Okay, not bad. Yeah, something simple like this, like the Looney Tune backgrounds and something might be good to start out with. But this is actually going to be your homework this week, which is practice drawing backgrounds and landscapes and things from photos. You can just look them up on Pinterest and gather a whole resource of these awesome backgrounds and then work on drawing them. Very good exercise. And next week we will be talking about how to speed paint, which is huge. That's a big deal. Okay, well, we are actually going to go into much greater detail on how to draw a background, because we are going to be drawing a background from Princess and the Frog. You'll have to forgive my printer. It looks like it's not printing blues. It's silly. First thing we want to draw is this rectangle. So let's get it down. This rectangle. Looks like we're close, maybe a little bit fatter here. All right, I think we're pretty close. If you're happy with that rectangle, if you feel it looks very close to what we've got here, then let's move on. Now remember, we talked about how the horizon line is so important. Look at how low this horizon line is. Now the horizon line, just to remind you, is where the sky meets the ground. Okay, so we've got the ground here, the sky or the building, or whatever the stuff that goes up is right there. So let's mark that on each edge of our page, and it looks like it's pretty straight across. Now sometimes you get pictures where the horizon line is we're inside a room, and so the horizon line might be like here and then here, so there might be several horizon lines. Technically there's only one horizon line, but when working with the planes, you got to kind of think of it a little bit different. Okay, let's connect these two little markers that we just made. Okay, when you're happy with that, let's move on to blocking out the big basic shapes. Now, if you look here, I didn't necessarily draw shapes, but what we drew were lines. And as you can see, those lines are all almost parallel, but not quite. And the reason is because we are in three-point perspective. And you can look up all these videos on perspective, and you've probably taken art classes telling you what perspective is. I'm just going to give you a really quick rundown of it. What happens is you draw a vanishing point. Let's see, and I can't draw it here because it'll go way off the page, but it looks like it's the vanishing point for this plane is about right here. And so all the lines would draw to that vanishing point. And then the vanishing point for this plane up here, if you can see, this goes straight up and down, but this tilts inward. So we have a vanishing plane that's way, or vanishing point that's way, way, way up there. And so all the lines would slightly curve into it. Sorry, I said three-point perspective. This is two-point perspective. Because these lines go like this, this goes like this. All right. So what we are just going to do is we're going to kind of follow these lines, and if you think parallel but just a little bit splayed, and what happens is as you get to closer to the horizon, the more straight it is going to go to the horizon, and then they splay out, you know, to here and to here and here, and that's kind of how you have to think about it. All right, let's get the edge of this building right here. All right, looks like it starts right about here, comes in right about here. Go ahead and draw that. All right, another marker on this is these front two pillars in the middle of the staircase. So let's get that. It looks like it's about right here. So this is almost in the middle, not quite. It's a little bit to the left of the middle. So if we marked the middle of this piece, this would be the other side. Okay, and then this would be there. All right, this is pretty much straight up and down. So let's draw this line almost straight up and down, no angle. All right, now if you look at this one, it is coming in just a little bit. I think we drew that a little bit too far. So pull that marker in. Okay, this is feeling about right. All right, let's mark the staircase here. And the way we're going to do that is we're going to hit this top stair. And it looks like it comes about to a little bit higher than that. If we drew the middle of this picture, this would be, this line would be about the middle. So it just comes about the middle. So if we want to mark the middle of our rectangle here, just very, very lightly, just for measuring purposes. Let's mark this right about, yeah, I'm gonna say it's about right here. Okay, it's marked down like this. Check out where the other side of the staircase pillar goes. It's about right here. Right about there. Okay. Let's get this staircase, or not this staircase, this railing right here. So we have middle post right here. Goes to about here. Remember, we marked this on the page. Let's mark this little guy. Let's bring him in. Now you always want to be double checking between here and here, making sure that we've got the right amount of space between here, and that looks about right, what we've got here. Okay, looks like we should probably snag this pillar. It starts right about here, has its little buddy right there. Remember, they splay out just a little bit. Okay. All right, let's get the side of the building here. Let's see. Let's mark them down here. We've got this one, and then this one, and I think I'm drawing those too low. Let's see if we can snag that a little bit higher. This comes about right here. These hit just below this line. Yeah, I was definitely too. Right about here. If you notice, this line continues to hit right there because it's the whole face of the building right there. So we can continue this line like this. All right, and let's draw these three red lines. This one's marking the top of this railing right here. And it's further out. Should be, let's see. This line's confusing me a little bit. I'm gonna erase it. This would be about here. Okay, we want to mark this up here. Goes like this. Mark this right about here. Goes like this. Okay. Yeah, that was right. Sure, Squeezle. That was fine. Okay, let's hit this line right here. This would be the next floor, the next story on this fancy mansion house. Okay, so we've got the basic perspective of the front of the building, and we'll go in and fill in details a little bit later, but let's get the staircase. Now, stairs are hard. And stairs are a lot like hair in that there's a lot of little elements, and you need to shape out the big elements first before going and getting the little elements down. All right, so let's get the shape of the staircase. Let's get the railings and the pillars, and then let's get the perspective and the stairs. All right, now if you look at this line that we drew here, rectangle goes about right here. So draw the rectangle right about here, so you can see at the bottom of that line. Take a look at this rectangle. It is tilted. And it is very near the edge of this page. Let's draw that. As you can see, we have this square up here marked. Let's mark this square up here, this bottom of a pillar. Goes about halfway between the line. There's one more. We're going to mark a little bit more of a rectangle right here. Okay. Go to here, go to here. Let's draw that line arching down. Okay, now if you take a look, this railing begins here. It almost comes straight down, turns around to the sky. Okay, and we can draw the bottom of that, kind of goes like that, and brings around like this. Let's hit the bottom of it on this side. Think I'm drawing that too fat. It goes into the middle of this. So. Okay, hey, not a bad shaped staircase, right? Let's break it up into pieces now. Let's cut it in half. Now, as you can see, that's what this line is. This line cuts it in half. Let's cut ours into half in half. Okay, let's cut it in half again down here. If you take a look, this line is a little bit bent. That's because the staircase is curved, so the stairs are not going to be quite parallel to each other. Okay, and then you'll be able to go in and count the stairs. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, the way we're looking at it, we'll probably be able to see a little top of the stair. That's what these white lines are right here. It might be a little bit tricky to draw. You can if you want to get super detailed, but you can just do the lines. Okay, and then you go up and you fill in the stairs just like we did there. The further up you get, the smaller the stairs are going to be because you can see less of them because our eye line, they're above our eye line, and so they just get thinner and thinner as they move up. Let's catch the other stairway right here. Now, as you can see, we have this piece kind of jutting out a little bit. I'm gonna to draw the edge here. And that edge would be kind of like that. If you can see, what's nice is that they have the bricks, and so if you follow the line of the bricks, it gives you a pretty good idea of what the perspective is on that plane. All right, so we have that coming out. Looks like the stairs start up right about here, and they slope down really close to the horizon line. And it kind of just goes down like this. All right, it slopes down like that. Great. All right, and I want you to do that same kind of line, just a little bit higher up here to echo the railing. There it is. Okay, hey, this is coming along, right? Let's get these pillars down. They're a little bit hard to see, but we have, they're not exactly pillars. I'm sure there is a technical name for those railings or balusters or balustrades or whatever they are. But I'm gonna call them pillars. All right, so we've got this one going like this. Remember, they go in just a little bit because we have a vanishing point. Okay, this goes out like this. We have another one right about there. Okay, now there is a line here that's very faint, difficult to see, but this marks the edge of the inner wall there. So we're going to mark that. Looks like it begins right about here. And maybe disappears behind here. Okay. We've got the top of this wall here. The entrance of stairway is about right here. This is the pillar. Here's a pillar. It's a box. Let's okay, and if you want, you can also draw a plane on that ceiling. Looks like ceiling keeps on going here. Comes in like this. Oh, I see what I did. Okay. This is the wall above. That's the story above. This is the ceiling. Okay. Pillars holding them up. That makes sense now. All right. These are, let's block out the floors in between. Looks like it's about right here. We can color that in just slightly, just to help us distinguish. We have a railing right here. And there is, so we have the floor down here, railing right here. Okay. If we're seeing too many lines, go ahead and erase the ones that we were just using as markers. Here we have our pillars. Okay. Looks like there's maybe an edge wall here. The windows. And we have a window here. We have a kind of window here. Oh, look, there's Tiana. Hello. You can draw her, you don't have to. Here. Okay, there is a piece of this piece that we're missing. And it is the front bush and fountain. Now this is gonna be a cinch, all right? All these perspectives and things have been the hard part. The easy part's gonna be the bushes and the fountain, right? Because they don't really need that kind of attention paid to perspective. Fountain maybe does. Go ahead and draw this circle. It's more of an oval. Right about here, see how close it is to the edge of that banister. We have a square beneath it, or sorry, a rectangle beneath it. Goes about this far off of the circle. And then we have a longer rectangle right about here. Okay, this is the fountain. If we look very carefully, we can see that it's actually a half circle here. There's water coming off of it. And then this is also a circle. If you looked at it from above, it would be a circle fountain. But since we're almost right on it, it looks like a rectangle. Okay, the bushes are a cinch. All right. Basically, we just do that. Oh, it has a little flourish behind it, which we will fill in greater detail. But first, we're getting down the basics. Looks like there's a face spurting water in this picture. That's interesting. What a lot of fun. Okay. Now I think we have the basics down. So, what we're going to do is I'm going to go in and I'm going to doll it up, and that's what I want you to do as well, is to look very closely at the picture and fill in the tiny details. Now that we've got the basic shape, we can do that. So let's begin.
Yes! Are you ready? You can blame my friends on the other side.
You got what you want. But you lost what you need.
Okay. Here we go. How did yours turn out? If you're discouraged about it, don't be. We picked a really hard one with lots of perspective lines, with a staircase. These are all really tricky elements. Go ahead if you need to. One thing that I want you to try and do this week is to draw a whole lot of backgrounds and then come back to this and see how much better that you've gotten and how stronger of a sense you have of perspective and planes and things like that. Okay. Also, don't get discouraged if it takes you a long time to fill out the details. I know that I speeded up on the video. This took me about good half an hour to get all the details and stuff in. And it still is really pretty sketchy. So don't get discouraged. Just keep at it. It's something that's going to take time. Now it's time for our favorite part of the show. Question and answer time! Okay, so this question and answer is a continuation from the question and answer that we had last week where we talked about sketchbooks. This question is, what kind of pens and pencils and markers or whatever do you use for sketchbooking? And I'll show you what I use. I would recommend that you do not use a pencil, because pencils smear, and by the time you're done with the sketchbook, it's just like really gross and smeary and stuff, and you don't want that. What I do recommend is getting some 0.7 blue lead and a mechanical pencil. Like what I have here, I don't think you can see it, but this is blue lead. They used to sell 0.9, which was wonderful because it didn't break as much, but 0.7 is good too. And the thing about colored lead is that it doesn't smear. Now, you can't erase it, but you're not supposed to be erasing what's in your sketchbook anyway. You're supposed to be just getting it down. All right, so that's the point of the sketchbook. So yeah, no pencil. I mostly use a 0.7 blue lead. You can order it on Amazon. For pens, I like to use the Precise V-Ball pen. Looks like this. You can just get it at Walmart or Amazon. Extra fine. Fine works too, but I like extra fine a little bit better. And it has actual ink inside it, like liquid ink. And it has a rolling ball, and it just goes on really smooth. So I like that. If you want to add color to it, I don't have any Prismacolor markers to show you, but Prismacolor markers are very good, especially if they're gray tone, because then you can get in the shading. And those are very expensive. I think they're maybe $4 for one marker, which is a little bit crazy, but it's also very good to have around. One of the things that I like to do with my sketchbook is I like to do a little bit of watercolor. I'm not great at it, but it's a good exercise. So what you want is a very fine tip Sharpie. Okay, because those will not blur or smear with watercolor. And then I have just a little small travel case of watercolors. You can order this little guy just on Amazon. Okay, travel case of watercolors, and I have a water brush pen. This is something also that you can order on Amazon. So you can see, it has water in here. You just squeeze it if you need more water. Brush tip, if you can see that. Pretty handy. One thing about this pen is that you probably will need to carry maybe a tissue or something with you when you're using it, so you can wipe it clean and then start on a new color every time you change colors. But I found that if I have those three or four pens and stuff with me, then I'm pretty much set to sketchbook anywhere. So that's what I use, and I think that you would like it to definitely get a pen and a colored pencil. Those are a must. Okay, so I hope that answers your question. I am so excited for you guys this week. This is going to be the best homework ever. I love, love, love drawing backgrounds. I think you will too. Your homework for this week is to practice drawing all sorts of backgrounds from animation, but you can also choose photos. You can also choose movie backgrounds. You can pretty much do whatever, as long as you're getting down the planes, as long as you're getting down the perspective and the horizon line, and just figuring out, you know, the buildup of each set. This is very good practice. Fill up your sketchbook with them. Do like 6 to a page. You don't need to do them big. You can do them small. But yeah, see if you can get that under your fingers. Very excited. Thanks so much for joining us another week. I can't wait to see you next week. It's going to be the best. All right. Bye-bye, guys.